Yeah. Hey, when you're talking about Eddie, by the way, what's going to happen with him and Connor? Who do you got in that fight?
I have Eddie. You know, I think obviously, you know, I can attest to Eddie's power, his tenacity, his cardio, his composure inside the cage. I spent nearly 50 minutes with that guy inside the cage. We have spilled more blood with each other than a lot of people will do in an entire career. You know, the wars that we were in, and I have a ton of respect for that guy. And I think Connor's only good when he's confident and when he's in his flow, when he's in his Connor movement state. You know, and I think it shows in the first round, and he's gonna be throwing that, his spinning stuff. He's gonna dig to the body. He's gonna throw that devastating left hand. And I think when he realizes he rocks Eddie, and Eddie recuperates, and Eddie comes back, and Eddie gets right back to his feet, and just like he has in so many fights, both fights that I were in, I rocked him numerous times, and he keeps fighting, he keeps coming. He has an indomitable will. So it's gonna be interesting to see how Connor reacts to that. The Connor that we saw in the first two rounds of the Nate Diaz fight, their second fight, the first two rounds compared to the last couple. Now, I give credit to Connor for I think, exceeding a lot of our expectations. A lot of us thought that his cardio was just going to tank and he was going to gas out and lose again, but he stuck it out for the full five rounds. I think Eddie has more composure, better crisp striking, better wrestling, better grappling, better all-around complete mixed martial arts techniques than Diaz does. So I think Eddie comes away with it with either a late finish, third, fourth, or fifth round, or a unanimous decision.
I see it that same way. And the one thing about Eddie is nobody's kicking that guy's ass. And they might beat him. You're a guy that can attest. There's ways to beat Eddie. There's ways to eat up the time and win some judges. But nobody's coming out and steamrolling Eddie Alvarez. Nobody. It's not going to happen. It has never happened. And that's one of Connor's biggest thing. He overwhelms guys. And when that storm's done, nobody's left standing. But I have to assume that Eddie will still be standing. And all of a sudden, you're in those later rounds, and it changes. Things change.
Yeah, that's when the fight really starts. And I can attest to that. I was that guy who, you know, before that Eddie Alvarez, my first 12 fights, I had 10 first-round finishes. You know, first-round finishes, stepping into the cage, fight was done within 4 minutes on average, you know. So you get used to going out there and steamrolling guys, and then all of a sudden you get in those wars where you're giving the guy your best shots, your heart rate is through the roof, your adrenaline is pumping, your the lactic acid is building. Then the war starts. Anybody can go out there and land a sweet, beautiful, swift punch on the chin, knock someone out, jump up on the cage and say, you know, give me my paycheck and let's go on to the next one. But when you get into those deep waters, you either sink or you swim. And, you know, like I said, got to give credit to Connor. He showed his heart in the first Diaz fight, what we thought was his heart, and, you know, basically giving up in the second round, but then still came back and won that decision. So you got to give him a little bit of credit. But when you talk about a war-hardened veteran of this sport, you're talking about Eddie Alvarez, the guy who's fought at the highest level in every single one of these organizations in the entire world. The dude knows how to compete, and it's exciting. You know, I think this fight is a big fight because there's so many people out there who think Connor is so great, and I do think he's a great fighter, but they're underestimating the will and the heart of Eddie Alvarez.
Yeah, I fully agree. And with your assessment of Connor, I agree with that too. I was a little late to the Connor bandwagon. I thought that it was a little bit of hype, and it's such a hard division. That belt jumps around. As you know, you guys are in the hardest weight class that there is, 155 or 145. I mean, those weights are, you got 10 John Joneses in each one of those weight classes. But to your point on Connor, yeah, he's proved himself. You know, the way he came back against Diaz, demanded the same match in the same city, same amount of rounds, same opponent, same weight class, and then lived up to it. He's the real deal. I just don't know if he can beat Eddie. I think there's a few guys that can definitely beat him, but maybe he could beat those guys too. I don't know. I am pretty excited for that match.
Yeah, I mean, it still remains to be seen. I think it's good for Connor. It was good for Connor to have lost that fight and then come back and, like you said, same opponent, same city, same weight, and then make people eat their words. You know, with with this great platform that you get put on, you get a lot of naysayers, a lot of doubters, and sometimes it depends on what you're motivated by. Do you want to prove those people wrong, or do you just want to continue to prove it to yourself? I think he proved something to himself. He proved something to a lot of the fans in the MMA industry, and it's a big time fight and a big time stage in Madison Square Garden, and it's going to be a good night for the UFC and a good night for all those guys on that card.
All right, so I got to put you on the spot here. So you came from the same room as Ben Askren and Tyron Woodley. You talked about those guys earlier. You're one of the few guys that have seen those two go at it. Ben Askren is undefeated. Tyron Woodley is the world champion. But you know who is the better fighter. You know the answer to this question. Can you tell me?
Actually, I've actually never been in the same mixed martial arts room with them, to be honest with you. I've never seen them spar. When it came to wrestling, Ben was head and shoulders above Tyron. Ben has a way of neutralizing every single one of your weapons. You look at Tyron Woodley, he's one of the most explosive, athletic, strongest, well-timed athletes in the entire world, in my opinion. And obviously, I'm a little bit biased, but Ben's the kind of guy that negates every single one of those things. It doesn't matter who you are, what day it is, how in shape Ben is. He's going to take away 90% of your arsenal, 90% of your weapons. He's going to roll you up and he's going to pin you. I'm not saying that he would go out there and pin Tyron in a wrestling match, but I think Ben definitely won that wrestling battle, and I can't attest to those guys sparring. You know, I think Ben has a very similar style when it comes to mixed martial arts as he did with wrestling. He's going to grab you. He's going to pick you up. He's going to put you down. He's going to make you hate your life for as long as the ref lets him torture you. So then you look at Tyron, the guy can knock out he would knock out King Kong, you know. So it would be an interesting matchup, and luckily I wouldn't have to pick and I wouldn't have to see them fight because I wouldn't want to see them fight.
Yeah, I could imagine. You know, I just love those old practice room stories. I came from a practice room. So many people would pay on pay-per-view or they'd ask questions. Who'd win between Randy Couture and Dan Henderson? Well, I know the answer. I watched it happen, but I can never say. Who'd win between Evan Tanner and Matt Lindland? Or, you know, Matt Lindland and Dan Henderson, you know, just go through the mix. It's like, well, I know the answer to that. I watch them fight, but I will take it to the grave. You can never tell those stories. And I'm starting to think that there's got to be like a moratorium on that. There has to be some amount of time that goes by where then it is okay to start telling those stories because they're really interesting. The practice room stories, you know, particularly wrestling and the martial arts background. If we would have had cameras set up, if we would have documented some of that, you could sell it on pay-per-view right now. The most fascinating matches ever took place in the practice room.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, it's the practice room too is such a, it's so much different than the fight. A lot of times, you know, there's some guys who, I mean, I'm sure you can attest to this. You go to the practice room and you can watch a guy and he looks like a top 100 fighter in the world. But then you put him under the lights, you put him inside the cage, and he shines like a rock star, and he looks like the best guy in the world. And then there's the opposite, where some guys are practice room guys, and then they get under the lights, and they clam up, or they get scared. They don't open up. They beat themselves a lot of times. And it's such a crazy sport, and it's so much different than football, baseball, basketball. It's so much different. And people who are just fans who have never competed in wrestling or mixed martial arts, they don't understand the intricacies of the emotional roller coaster that we have had to go through from wrestling into mixed martial arts, and then as mixed martial artists, how much is on the line now. You know, back in wrestling, it was just, oh, I just don't want to lose to this Oklahoma State guy because they're our arch nemesis. I just don't want to lose to him because I'm Mizzou and Mizzou pride and this and that. Now, you lose a fight, you're losing money. You're losing you're taking a notch on your record, a loss on your record. You're losing a little bit of your world ranking. Now you've got to get back a couple more fights to you can get another big money fight and this and that. So there's so much more on the line. There's so much pressure in this sport. So it's such an interesting, crazy sport, both the sport of wrestling, which I love honestly more than the sport of mixed martial arts, if I'm completely honest. And it's just such an interesting thing. But I agree, if you had some video footage, some live feed footage of some of those sparring matches with some of these guys, it would be pay-per-view worthy.
Yeah, no, I agree. All right, let me throw another one out there at you. And this match isn't going to happen, sadly, but let me get your opinion. Grappling rules, okay, let's call it EBI rules. Josh Barnett versus Neil Melanson?
Neil Melanson all day long.
I want to see that match. I've always wanted to see that match.